The wait is over. Now two has arrived. Chart-topping hits, all in one mind-blowing collection.
Hit me, baby, one more time.
Welcome back, everyone, to episode 2 of NOWCast, the peak of pop. Today, we're going to be talking about Now That's What I Call Music, Volume 2, which was released in early 1999. And boy, can you vaguely tell. So I don't really think we need to do like an interlude or like an introduction with any of this, but this time I am actually going to read out the descriptions for these songs that we're going to be talking about, because there's like little descriptions in the back. So they tell you like, it's kind of like a thing where, it's kind of like a time capsule. Where they're like, oh, here's this and this and the reasons for it. I mean, I don't know if anyone else does it like that, but they did it like that so you can know what the heck they're talking about. As usual, I'm joined by Andy B from the YouTube channel Andy Drew Bees. Hello, Andy.
Hello there. Hi, everybody. Hello, potential listeners. We're back for the second time.
Yay.
Talking about Now That's What I Call Music again. great to be here. Yes, it is. Great to be back again.
Good, good. We should like come up with some kind of tagline or something. Us brave souls journey to the bottom of the Now That's What I Call Music bin to dig out some possible gems or possible mishaps.
Oh boy. Don't worry, folks, as this series will go on, I'm sure by episode 24 we'll have a decent tagline. Don't worry. We'll get there.
Maybe.
Possibly. No promises.
I chose that for the title because, I mean, it's supposed to be the peak of pop. They're picking the best pop songs. Well,
yeah.
I guess not best as in, like, objectively, like, oh my god, it's amazing, but best as in, like, the best-selling, the most influential, the most popular at the time, which I don't really think is such the case nowadays when anything and everything can become a hit. But back then, like, the hits were hits. Like, they genuinely, like, people remembered them. Like, can you think of a single popular song from last year?
I can think of a few. Yeah, 2022, let's see.
But Tom the Shadow said there wasn't really like a song of the summer. It was like song of the summer was the song from the winter, because As It Was came out in like winter. There wasn't like big summer song. Well, even Despacito came out in winter, but you know what I mean, like that took a while to get popular. Anyway, what was happening in 99? Well, Taking Back Sunday was formed in 99.
Oh boy, your favorite.
My favorite. Albums released were albums like Enema of the State. I think Americana was released that year, was it?
No, it's a previous year, 98.
Previous year? Crap. Well, it's fine because a lot of these songs on here are from 98, so it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
99 is definitely one of my favorite years, though, and as we go through more of these, you'll see why. This album was... All right, there were some real boring songs on here, but the good ones were, like, really good. So, without further ado, let's get started with track number 1, Britney Spears' Baby One More Time. My loneliness. So what the booklet says is this bright, beautiful teen from Kentwood, Louisiana has raced up the Billboard charts with her number one album, Baby One More Time. Already a teen sensation, Britney continues to take the pop world by storm. Boy, were they right about that.
Yeah, seriously, they hit that nail on the head.
So this is the first single ever released by Britney. Bitch. And it is definitely one of my favorites by her.
I mean,
that iconic piano. That music video, controversial music video, iconic. I hate saying iconic, but it truly is.
I think that's fair.
Do you know why it's called Da 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 Baby One More Time? Do you know the origin of it? All right.
I do not know the deep lore.
It's all because of Max Martin. English was not his first language. He was still like getting a hold of it. So when he was writing it, he thought that like the phrase "hit me, baby, one more time" is like, "hey, like call me back."
Right.
In our language, "hit me" does not mean it that way. So it made it sound even more like, I guess, like sensual or like sexual.
Yeah.
And that
or
kind
possibly
of way.
Like or possibly domestic, depending on the interpretation.
Yeah, no kidding. So, and then obviously you can't, they're like, oh, we couldn't possibly call it Hit Me Baby One More Time. So they call it Da 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 Baby One More Time, which I don't know. I just love that.
I didn't think there was a, it's funny to me. I love you're like, do you know the lore behind the three dots in Baby One More Time? It's like, no, I don't. I didn't think there was, but lo and behold, there is lore
I'm
for the three dots.
I'm the resident Britney stan here. Hello.
Hey, fair
like,
enough.
I could gush about the song. Like, I don't know. Like, I just love the song. It's amazing. Like, she, Britney, you know, has that iconic voice, but like, man, can she hit some low notes. Like, I kind of always struggle to do that. No. Like, kind of like that.
Ah, showing off the vocal chops.
I was like,
see.
I struggle. Hits it perfectly. It took me a while, though. So what are your thoughts about Baby One More Time?
Well, it's a song I'm definitely... Well, I'm not as much of a Britney stan as you are, per se. But it's one I definitely remember I heard a number of times as a kid. And I can appreciate it more now that I'm older. Because at the time, I was just sort of like, eh, it's girly, whatever. But, you know, as I got older, I hadn't heard it actually in full in quite a while. And but no, I have to say, it's a pretty solid slow jam, man. It's really strong melodically. Like, ooh, I actually really loved the verse melodies and the even just that and the chorus melodies and stuff. There actually is kind of this little tinge of I want to say darkness per se, but there's kind of like, well, not really darkness, but because it's in like a minor key, like those like really moody minor key melodies. Because it's one of those cases where like they can sound like minor key melodies. I feel can sound either really dark but also really sensual at the same time, and especially with the very like kind of funky like backing track here. It falls more in like the sensual category and stuff. One thing that I actually forgot about the track, because I hadn't listened to it in full in quite some time, I forgot about how, like, after the second chorus, it cuts out, and it's just, like, this, it's just this quiet, like, piano-focused bridge, and I thought it was, like, made for a nice dynamic change there. I'm like, oh, that's cool. But that being said, though, I'd have to say my one kinder critique of this track is that I found it to be a tad bit repetitive given the length. It's not. It's the thing is that it didn't necessarily bother me per se. Like, I still was enjoying it, and I noted the fact that, like, oh, they're doing like that chorus like one more time, or they're doing like this section one more time. Ironically, Baby One More Time, you know. But yeah, I didn't personally mind it too much, but I still marked it as a kind of a point against this song. But that being said, it still really was a solid slow jam. And you mentioned about not liking to use the word iconic, and I'm sort of in a similar camp. But yeah, I think it's fair to say that this really was kind of an iconic track. We'd mentioned in the last episode about like how in like 97 pop music was in this like, or I guess it was 98. Pop music, like, you know, pre-Britney was kind of in this era, like in this weird period where there wasn't really like a defining, like leading sound for pop music at the time. At least I think as far as we kind of saw it. And then like, again, like you have a track, like, you know, Britney Spears comes out and a track like Baby One More Time happens. And it really kind of sets the template. It's sort of like, you know, how Enema of the State, you know, set the template for pop punk moving into the new millennium. I feel like a track like Baby One More Time really kind of set the precedence for pop music moving into the new millennium as well.
Absolutely, and that has a lot to do with the fact that Max Martin, like, came on the scene as a producer, because he was the leading driving force behind, like, every single big pop star boy band you're gonna be seeing. And there are definitely some Max Martin traits here, like the weird kind of, like, almost, like, genderless sounding choir in the back. There's like a mix of like male and female voices singing along with her. And he just loves to drive those, of course, like here's a chorus like with more added vocals onto it. And then the next time he puts out like another like set of like vocal lines, or like kind of like freestyling over it as the chorus repeats again, like when she does the "I must confess that my loneliness," like that part.
Oh, yeah,
well, that's
yeah.
part of the bridge. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's just like vocals,
yeah, yeah.
vocal layering is everywhere.
Oh yeah, like
he
yeah, towards the
that.
End, like oh yeah, that's like a big like that's a really like classic pop song element. I guess that came from him, to be honest. Where it's like the final chorus is like, well, like with the final repetition, they add extra like layers on top of it,
Reminds
which is
me
like
of
a
bye,
great.
Bye.
Exactly, and which is a great technique to use, because it adds, even like when you're repeating a section, adding just that new element gives it, like, it helps it from feeling, I know I was saying the song was repetitive, but that particular songwriting element helps to alleviate repetition in songs. So it's, again, it was a smart choice.
I think the song's perfect. One of the most perfect pop songs in existence.
I don't know if I go that far myself, but it is pretty damn good. I will give it credit. I will say okay. that.
Did it age well? Yes. Absolutely. Yes. Setting the precedent for pop music from years going on, pop music in general. Absolutely. Let's move Definitely. On to the next track. Next track is New Radicals. You get what you give. You got the music in you. Don't let go. You got the music in you. One dance left. The swell is gonna pull through. Led by singer-songwriter Greg Alexander, New Radicals combine infectious melodies with catchy lyrics. On their debut album, Maybe You've Been Brainwashed Too, New Radicals hit the jackpot with their single, You Get What You Give. Speaking of classic, perfect pop songs. Here's a pop song by a one-hit wonder by a band from Michigan from their one album. They're a one-album wonder, too.
That's all they need. It was just the one.
Man, I still need to listen to this album. But yeah, fun fact, Greg Alexander was originally from Michigan. I remember seeing that in Todd's video, and I'm from Michigan, so shout out to Michigan.
There you go. Especially in Michigan.
Michigan represent.
this is a fun one though. Really, really positive, upbeat track. Oh no, it's really great. This is one where it's kind of interesting because this is an example of a song that's really built around one really solid vocal melody and rhythm. You know, like da 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 na 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 da na na na. Yeah, which is super super infectious and it's funny too because even though it repeats like throughout the majority of the song.
He just keeps like adding on like the like that part. Man, I love that. When he just totally. Hits those notes. Oh my god. I'll guess while you try to come up with what you're gonna say, I'll just go on. It is a really positive song. You've got the music in you. Don't let go, you've got the music in you, one dance left, this world is gonna come through. It is really positive energy. But sometimes you just need that lift me up. And yeah, totally. Gotta talk about the ending where he takes snipes at various people. Courtney Love, he certainly does, Manson, yeah. Beck and Hansen, all that stuff.
It is funny because it comes good. In like the last like 30 seconds of the track. It's just sort of like, oh, this really positive, like upbeat, happy song. And then the last 30 seconds, like it's a kick of your ass. It's like, oh, okay.
Definitely threatened by the scrawny bald man who covers his face with a bucket hat. Yes, very scary.
Yeah, a bucket hat. Yeah, swinging a big bat there, fella. Okay. No, it is funny though because I do give this song credit because typically with positive songs, like especially with sometimes really overtly positive songs, sometimes they can be. Actually, I'm okay with that one. But but typically speaking, with overtly like positive songs, I find them to be kind of too gushy for their own good, and sometimes that's kind of a turnoff to me. But this is an example of like a positive song with like a positive message that isn't like obviously it's very catchy and upbeat, but it's not like too. I guess I don't find it to be too overbearing with its happiness. I don't know if that sounds angsty or something, but. It's a good thing. I'm trying to make a compliment here is what I'm trying to get at.
It's like really corny stuff, like fight song that is just incredibly corny. Oh, it's like, yeah, I get the message, trying to be positive. It's like, Hallmark Cardi.
Exactly. I don't like, yeah, I don't.
It's that sweet spot.
Yeah, I don't like Hallmark happiness. I think that's a good way to put it.
But the song is like about, I guess, taking, not like really taking risks, but like just grasping what's the moment and enjoying it. And I think maybe that has to connect with the end where he just starts, like, listing off people. He's like, I have this one chance. Like, to quote Eminem, you only got one shot. You do not get two shots. So he's just like, yeah, what the hell? This is going to be my moment. I'm going to be as ridiculous as possible. It is ridiculous, over the top, late 90s goodness. Did this track hold up?
Yes.
Yes.
Definitely.
Yes.
Simply put, yes.
Oh, incredible. Okay, next track, I like this one, is Robbie Williams with Millennium. We got stars and Take That teen idol, Robbie Williams has cracked America with his hit single Millennium, a sublime portent that simultaneously gives voice into and soothes global Y2K anxieties. His stateside debut, The Ego Has Landed, is a work of staggering depth and promise. So you're probably like, who the hell is Robbie Williams? So as it said, He's a former member of the boy band, a UK boy band, Take That, a big, huge, like, success over in the UK, like, Justin Timberlake levels of success over there. It reminds me, like, this one bit I saw, like, it was one of his early performances. He had, like, this huge hit, and he was singing it to the audience at this festival, and everyone was singing along, like, every single person knew the lyrics. Like, that's insane. So this was his attempt over here, one of two, to make a single, like a big single over here. This one was, it kind of did well. The next one was Rock DJ, which that music video. That music video, right?
Oh, yeah.
That didn't do totally. Anything, but that's my personal favorite by him. And I wish I knew more. I really like this track. I love Robbie Williams. He's a lad.
You're definitely more familiar with Robbie Williams than I am, I'll tell you that. Because his name sounded vaguely familiar to me. I think I may have heard of one or two other tracks by him, possibly. But I think every time I saw his name, though, I just kept thinking, like, oh, Robin Williams. No, never. Like, yeah, oh, never mind.
Robin Williams had a music career?
I mean, I'd love if that was the case, man. He actually had a good voice, so.
But I love the... Like the swelling of the orchestra in the background. It's very unique. You don't see too many songs with, like, just orchestras as, like, the main backbone. I can only really think of, like, Bittersweet Symphony or, like, Viva La Vida for that.
Actually, no joke, in my notes here, yes, by the way, I do have notes. I did write how the track did remind me, like, the string melodies reminded me a lot of Bittersweet Symphony. I think, actually, jokingly enough, I said that I just described the song as if Bittersweet Symphony was written by Sublime, just because of some of the vocal passages. No, because some of the vocal passages to me in the verse, I don't know, were very Sublime-like to me. I don't know. That might be a weird comparison to make.
Yeah, no way.
But, I don't know. Especially because, not to get ahead of ourselves, but there is a Sublime track, like a Sublime track later on this disc. And, like, I don't know, just like the vocal passages, like the, I don't know, like it reminded me of, because there's sort of this, like, I don't want to say rapping necessarily, but there was this kind of like
sing-songy. Like,
yeah, sing-songy, like, kind.
That's kind of weird. Sure, but you get my point.
No, fair. I see. We're both making weird comparisons, but yes, I do get sing-songy is not a bad way to describe it. So I did, again, it was weird comparison, but yeah, it did definitely remind me of Bittersweet Symphony. That much I know for certain. So.
I think the orchestra was a sample of something. Oh, okay. The song borrows heavily from the musical arrangement of John Barry's You Only Live Twice, title track of the James Bond film, said to be one of Robbie Williams' favorite James Bond movies. But it's re-recorded in a different key.
There's some lore
reasons
for you.
Of cost. Fun fact, the music video is actually a pastiche of James Bond movies as well, just in case you didn't know he was British.
Yeah, just again, now you do.
He's like he's such a lad, like James Bond. Like, he's kind of, you know, flirts with the ladies, has like soaring high ego. That's why it's called The Ego Has Landed. He's just such a lad, such a likable lad, in my opinion.
He sounds cool, yeah.
I think, check out Rock DJ. The track, I think, well, probably because it samples an orchestra, I think has aged well in that regard. Because you can't, like, orchestral samples can't really age well. If it does age poorly, I think you've done something wrong.
Right. I guess because it's like they tend to be old enough as it is, per se. So it's like, once something's, like, old, it's already old, per se. So, I mean, I don't know if that makes any sense. Like, once something's old, it stays old. Like, you know, it continues to get older, but it's like, you know, I feel like I'm trying to make a point here, but I don't actually have a point here.
No, I see where you're going with this.
I don't know. I will say, one thing I will say I did like about this track, again, I overall thought it was okay, just for my overall thoughts. There was one verse, though, I quite liked, or one section of a verse that I quite liked. It was the line, live for liposuction and detox for your rent, overdose at Christmas and give it up for Lent.
Oh my God, yes, I love that line.
Oh, yeah, no, I thought that was a really sweet verse, yeah.
That's good. Yeah, the play on words. I also really like, this is kind of weird, but I really like syncopated laughing in songs where he goes, ah-ha-ha-ha, like, perfectly on beat.
Oh, totally.
I freaking love that. It's so good.
Yeah, anyone can laugh, but to laugh on beat, that means something.
The only other examples remind me of, like, the Will Smith song, Will 2K, or, like, one of them, and A Larger Than Life by Backstreet Boys. Hey, that again. Anyway, next song is a Closing Time by Semisonic. I know who I want to take me home. I know who I want. elevates itself from the modern rock milieu, Semisonic scored a smash hit with Closing Time from their sophomore album Feeling Strangely Fine. Ah, gushing about Semisonic, let's go. But I'll give it to you first.
Oh, why thank you, good miss. Yeah, Closing Time by Semisonic, super solid pop rock tune. It's a very, very 90s, distinctively 90s pop rock track. Just in terms of its, particularly from like its instrumentation and its chord progression, and maybe I'm partially biased because of the very killer two-screen music video, which I quite like.
Oh yeah, I grew up with that music video too. It's awesome.
Yeah, but what really stands out to me about this song is two particular things. Really, it's the verses that for me sell this entire song. Because I love the verse melody, incredibly catchy. In my opinion, actually, it outshines the chorus in terms of catchiness, to be honest. The chorus, I think, is all right, but the verse, to me, is incredibly solid, and to me, the really sing-along part. Because it also has, to me, all the great lyrics as well. Because that's another aspect of this song I think is super well done. Lyrically speaking, I think it's super solid. Because there is kind of like multiple, not interpretations, but there's a couple different meanings to the lyrics, necessarily. It has that quality of, like, it's the end of the day, the bar's closing, it's time to get up and move on, you know. But also, I think that the singer-songwriter of the band, like the front man,
Dan Wilson.
Yes, Mr. Dan Wilson. I believe that also some of the lines were directed towards his daughter, who was just born pretty, like, around the time when the song was being written.
Yeah. It's like a rebirth, like, starting over kind of thing, like, closing one end, bookend on your life and opening up another kind of thing. Chapter.
Yeah, exactly.
Closing one chapter of your life and, like, going to the next one.
No, exactly. And, like, a lot of there's a lot of great lines you can just pluck out of this song, you know. You don't have to go home, but you can't stay here.
Every new beginning comes from some other beginning's end.
Some other beginning's end.
Yeah.
Even just, like, what else is there? I think, like, there's one more I'm thinking
of. I want to make a playlist of, like, songs where it says something really deep and then it follows it up with, yeah. Please help me
that's
with
the best
that.
Thing. It's, oh, I definitely will. I think that's a great concept because it's, like, it's confirmation. You say something very profound, you know, every new beginning comes from some other beginning's end. Really? Yeah.
I can't think of the other songs that do that. Dang it. But there are quite a few.
And that's what the playlist is going to be for.
Yeah, if I can do it. Just the song, yeah. The piano. I love the piano, the guitars. I'm really, really going in deep here with my love for this song.
I like the piano. I like the guitars.
Basically, everything that you said. I do love songs with double meanings, and this one does have quite a bit. And I think I remember the song quite well because I did see the music video so much for it on TV as a kid that it was one of the songs and music videos that I just hold really, like, dear to my heart, like Semi Charm Life. Although I don't really remember the music video for that one that much. I just remember I loved the song, and that was, like, the first CD that I asked my mom for to get me.
Oh, the
was
first,
that one. So Third
first,
Eye Blind
Third
was
Eye Blind?
The first CD I ever got.
Oh, there you go. More Caesar lore, everybody.
Any other thoughts about the song? Because I surprisingly don't have a lot to say.
That definitely surprises me. You're usually full of so many opinions.
I know, but you basically said everything that I wanted to say.
Let's see.
If you want to play this in any place,
make sure to play it before you leave because everyone may actually think it's closing time.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. Don't play this at the beginning. Don't play this at the start of the night. It's like, well, better gather up our jackets, move to the exits, you know.
That was an option at the golf place, like, to play that song. And I'm like, surely they play this for, you know, closing time, right? I can't possibly play this right now, right? It feels sacrilege.
Totally. Yeah, everyone actually will. There are, especially with 90s kids. If you get enough 90s kids in a room and then play Closing Time, they will automatically walk towards the door.
Okay.
Even if they just get there, it's like, oh, hey, welcome. The show's starting in just 10 minutes. You play Closing Time, they're going to leave.
Doesn't this song also have, like, really common chords, too? A chord production structure?
I think it does. I think it actually has the... what was I going to say? I think it actually does have... I think it has the, like, you know, the famous, like, 1-5-6-4. I think this one actually does use the 1-5-6-4.
Beato!
Yes, 1-5-6-4. Beato. Pat Finnerty reference. There you go.
First one. Any other thoughts? Oh, second.
No, I think that's, I think it's closing time for this segment of the video because I think we've said everything there is about...
Yes.
Definitely.
It's constant yeses in the first half, but it's going to go all downhill from here in the second half.
Newfound glory all downhill from here.
Yes, next song is U2, Sweetest Thing, the single mix. Hit 8, it became a bona fide hit for the U2 when it was remixed and released single from the best of 1980 to 1999, an album that celebrates the first decade of U2's extraordinary history. Wow, they're really acting like U2's some Greek gods over here.
Well, to some people they really are, especially after coming out with Joshua Tree. There's some people like really love that album.
I mean, here's my thoughts on U2. They're mid. They have some pretty good songs, but I'm not like a huge fan.
Yeah, I'm kind of with you there.
They're kind of middle of the road for me. This song was good, but you know what it reminded me of? It reminded me of
It Must Be Loved by Madness.
I can kind of see that, yeah.
Do you see it? It has not like a reggae beat, but it has like a really specific beat to it that I'm like, wait, this sounds familiar.
Yeah, it has a sort of like hop to it in a way.
I mean, I do like this one. It's definitely up there for me in U2 songs that I can stomach.
I guess just for my general thoughts on U2, I do agree. I'm not the biggest U2 fan, though. I have immense nostalgia for Beautiful Day, so I'll give them that. Not a big fan?
Yeah, no, I'm pretty sick of that song. I used to love it, and I'm just like,
Fair enough. I remember it from back in the day, so even now I can go back to that one and be like, oh, yay, beautiful nostalgia. But yeah, overall, there's like, I was never super into them. And let's just say this song didn't exactly change my mind. I'd say if you're asking me like, oh, we're going to go downhill. This is the first real, like, you know, I think this is the first real weak track. Yeah, first real dud on the CD. Certainly not the last, but definitely the first. I will say Bono's high notes, like, you know, like, baby's got blue skies. It was really funny to me I first heard it.
He's trying to be, like, soulful or something.
Yeah, well, he's trying to be something, all right. I don't know. Good? I don't know.
All right, so is that what we got for that track?
I suppose it's what we got. It's what I've got, Sublime.
I said remember that. Sorry if I'm kind of far away from the mic. I'm coloring at the same time over here, and I'm trying
to look for a
colored pencil. All right, that one didn't age well, I guess, if we both agree that it's kind of mid. Know.
Well, I mean, at least the two of us think it's mid. I can imagine some other people being like, U2 what are you talking about? It's one of the greatest U2 songs of all time. And I'm like, really?
I mean, it was like not released on Joshua Tree for a reason. That means it's not good enough. There are always some like tracks, like missing tracks from albums that people really like, though, that are actually better than the full album. Like TBS, I know, has quite a few of those, so...
Oh, they certainly do. So and you've made not
always the case.
Next well, anyway, track. There we go.
Next track is Sheryl Crow, My Favorite Mistake. Did you know when you go, it's the perfect ending to the bad day. I was just beginning. When you go, all I know is you're my favorite. I like this one. Following the success of the multi-platinum success of her first two albums, Sheryl Crow scores again with the Globe Sessions. Featuring the hit My Favorite Mistake, the critically acclaimed album was awarded a Grammy for Best Rock Album and has been certified platinum by the RIAA. I'm not good with acronyms. Rock album, really? I guess she is kind of rock, but I always kind of thought of her as a bit country as well.
Yeah, did it really win a Grammy for rock? I'm surprised.
Dude, Grammys are always messed up for rock. Muse got nominated for Best Metal Performance this year. They did not win.
Oh, well, then again, yeah, we're talking about the same award show where, very famously, you know, 1988, you know, Jethro Tull won the Best Metal Award over Metallica, who should have gotten it that year. But, I mean, that's old news anyway, so.
Oh, my God. No, I like this track. It's pleasant. I don't really have... I mean, it's a good track. What do you think?
I have a couple of thoughts on this one. My favorite mistake. So, I don't know a whole ton of Sheryl Crow songs, but the ones I've heard, I quite like. She did this great track for the King of the Hill soundtrack CD from like 98 called Straight to the Moon. Very, very obscure track, but actually really, really solid. I like her voice quite a bit. It's very relaxing to me. Super smooth, very relaxing. And this one was pretty good too. It was one of the better slow jams on this compilation, because there's, I guess, spoiler, there's quite a few slow jams on the back half. But overall, yeah, very pleasant instrumentation. I loved the Rhodes keyboard solo towards the in the middle. I heard the song was rumored to be about Eric Clapton, but I think later she confirmed it wasn't. I don't think she ever really revealed who her favorite mistake was, per se, but...
I was like, I always think of Eric Clapton as an old guy, but I guess he wasn't as old back in the day. Duh. Still older than her, probably, but...
Oh, definitely at the time, I think, yeah. I mean, at one point in history, yes, Eric Clapton was young.
Eric Clapton, favorite jazz artist. Yeah, it's a good track. It's pleasant. Yeah. Anything else?
No, my favorite mistake overall, pretty solid.
I like when she says, my favorite mistake.
That's nice.
It's a good melody. It's a good vocal run. Next up, really like Fatboy Slim, Praise You, radio edit. Fatboy Slim has long been one of the world's most sought-after DJs and the forerunner of the Big Beat movement. His second album, You've Come a Long Way, Baby, has been certified gold and is on its way to platinum, thanks in no small part to the wondrous piano highs of the radio hit Praise You. This is like one of the first like viral music videos too. It has like a bunch of people dancing in like a subway or like, it's at somewhere and they're like dancing all dorkily and stuff. It's like kind of pre-internet memery, I guess.
In a way, yeah.
So interesting fact about that. So, the version I got was not the radio edit. I hear that one is in mono, actually. So I got the CD, because I ripped the tracks. I got the CD from a Salvation Army, and the disc wasn't in there, so I made it myself. And Andy listened to it on YouTube. So we're not going to have, like, highly accurate, but, like, who really cares? Praise You is Praise You, or as I hear it, Praise You. Praise You.
Praise You.
The sample I hear Praise You. Like what is that? Some kind of soup?
It's Caesar stand-up hour though. Here.
I do enjoy it.
I think it's all right. I think honestly you probably will have more opinions about this than I will. I thought it was all right, pretty up tempo, pretty fun. I like the main piano line.
I would like to hear your opinion on, so I do love me some Fatboy Slim, not the best track off of You've Come a Long Way, Baby. That's gonna go to Gangsta Trippin' by far. Gangsta Trippin', Kino. But this one, you can really hear, like, the earliness of, like, electronics, because the dragging out of the, like, shit, is, like, so rough. You can hear the,
Oh, yeah, so rough. Totally. Well, you know, they were getting there.
Poor guy, he was trying. It wasn't quite there. I mean, maybe now if he made it, it would not sound as rough. But there is also kind of like, not wholesome. It's kind of like an adorableness and like how he's trying to make it, like stretch it out, but it doesn't sound as good. So I don't know. There's some kind of novelty in it. But yeah, it's a good track. Repetitive, but it's an electronic track. Electronic tracks usually have like three lines in them anyway. The main point is the instrumentation, not the vocals, which is always an interesting aspect for me when it comes to electronic music.
Yeah, very focused on like one solid groove and just kind of keeping that going throughout the song.
Any other thoughts on this track?
Not particularly, at least not on my end.
Unless you have just a little in terms of the instrumentation, but in terms of the vocal sample, no. But it does sound incredibly 90s. Speaking of incredibly 90s, next up is my favorite track from here. I Think I'm Paranoid by Garbage. And Complicated. One of Spin Magazine's top 10 albums of the year, version 2.0, garnered rave reviews and platinum record sales. I Think I'm Paranoid is the inspired second single and shows Garbage on the cutting edge of today's music. So did this one surprise you? Putting Garbage on here for... This is their alternative rock pick on this album. The not entirely, like, mainstream kind of thing.
Well, considering some of the later picks on the CD, I wouldn't say I was surprised that Garbage was on the CD. As for the artist Garbage, well, that was definitely a surprise. I definitely was, though. I mean, it's a very distinctly, like, 90s track, but, like, to say, like, I didn't remember it being, and this could be my memory failing me, but I never really heard the song being, like, a big, like, general, like, generally, when I think of, like, big 90s tracks, I don't really think of this one, to be honest.
No, the one on the, there's a spoiler, there's another Garbage song on the next one, Special, that I think was more mainstream than this one. This one, Special, is a little more, like, mainstream friendly. I Think I'm Paranoid is definitely more edgy, but, oh man, I love this one. The guitar riffs on it, the weird, like, reverse thing in the background, the way it, like, it, of course, the way it explodes on the chorus, and, like, the later chorus when the guitar goes...
Yes, exactly like that.
But... No, my favorite part is when vocalist Shirley Manson, when she goes the and the music goes like bend me, break me. It's so good. I love the line bend me, break me, any way you need me, all I want is you. Man, so good.
It was pretty solid track. I actually really liked the quirky main riff in the verse there. To me that riff was a very 90s kind of riff. Overall, a lot of the clean lead guitar work throughout the song was actually I thought was pretty solid, especially like the, I don't know if it was in the first chorus, but the, like the little clean like lead in the, I think maybe the second chorus possibly, like after the vocal, like which would come after the vocals. I also thought was very pleasant as well too. The chorus in it of itself actually was my favorite, in terms of vocal melody, was my favorite section of the track. It had a very airy kind of quality. I think also with some of the chords in the back, it had a very airy quality to it, which I quite liked.
Can you believe that she's Irish? Shirley Manson?
Sure. Sure, I can.
I didn't know. Because her neutral accent is very, very good. It did not age the best, but it aged the best in my heart.
And that's all that really matters.
All right, next track. I know you're going to be excited about this one. Cake, Never There. The first single from the gold album Prolonging the Magic shows Cake again displaying the magic they're known for. Catchy songs rife with vocal harmonies fueled by guitars, trumpets, and lean grooves. I need your arms around me. I need to feel your touch.
Oh yeah. It's a Cake. Yeah, Cake's a super unique and distinctive band, especially with their vocal style, like the sort of like talking, half singing vocal style. Very, you always know it's them. I really dig this song. This is one of my favorites off the compilation. I haven't heard it again. It was just funny because I haven't heard a whole ton of Cake songs, but I have a few artists like this where I haven't heard a whole ton of their material, but the stuff I have heard I quite like, and Cake definitely falls into that category. Like, I'm very familiar with, obviously, The Distance, and I love that track.
Reluctantly crashed at the starting line.
Yeah. Patience. Thumping. Engines.
Thumping and pumping.
And
thumping. I don't know.
Oh, dude, honestly, the sun has gone down and the moon has gone up. Anyway, yeah, this one was, I thought, was really great. I loved the sneaky, spy-esque feel to it with the riffs and the general groove of the track. There was a lot of little elements in it that I really liked. A lot of, like, smaller, distinctive parts, whether it was the horn part in the post-chorus, followed with the little synthesizer. I think it was a square wave, maybe.
Yes.
Yeah, boop, beep, boop, like the boops and beeps. I think Cake does that really, really well, where they have... a lot of very distinctive parts come together to make this really great, overall, quirky, very fun musical picture. I think they're really good at doing that.
I do agree. Any other things you like about the song? Because did I even say my piece about
it? I don't think you say your take on Cake.
Oh, man. Well, it's hard to put into words. A lot of the songs on this album, I'm just like, I don't really know what to say. Like, this isn't my most favorite Now album, but, like, it isn't, like, my least favorite either. But a lot of the songs in here is like, yeah, this song is good, and I don't know why. So definitely one of them. I love the way he goes, like, I need your understanding, I need your love so much. And the crowd chanting in the background. Of course, you always could have him going, oh, yeah.
Oh, no. I do get what you mean about this not being your favorite. I mean, in their defense, I mean, this was like, it's the second one, you know, they're going to get better. They got like 50 of them. They got to get good at some point.
The peak is probably around 16, but yeah, good song. I think it's aged pretty well.
Actually, this might be a case where, honestly, I think if this song had come out in the last few years, I think it probably could have garnered just as much success, or maybe have cultivated a different audience. Maybe this is just me, because of the quirkiness of this track. I feel like this actually be in kind of the TikTok era. For some reason, I just see this song like like I could see it doing really, really well and kind of like taking off. I don't know, there's something about the quirkiness of this track I think would really, even like now, I think would capture people's attention.
Zoomers have discovered cake.
I mean, they could, you never know.
Oh no.
Next track is Peak. 98 Degrees, Because of You. Oh boy, another slow song.
You're my sunshine after the rain. You're the cure against my fear and my pain. Cause I'm losing my mind.
I don't know many
98 Degrees songs, but one of three that I do know is Give Me One More Night, Una Noche, and that is like, oh man, that one is keynote. But they're primarily known for their ballad songs, so one listen to the tender Because of You, and it's easy to see how 98 Degrees have built the reputation as premier balladeers. Their platinum album 98 Degrees and Rising, the harmony-driven Ohio foursome have entered the next stage of their flourishing career. Just gonna peek and then go right down.
Yeah, they entered it and then like immediately went out. But yeah, what do you gotta say about this one?
It's all right. I don't know. I get bored by a lot of these ballads. Once I hear this, I'm like, oh, time to go to sleep.
you know it's about to be like, oh, here we go. Yeah, this one I thought was just okay. I wasn't crazy about it. Spoiler warning, there's a worse boy band ballad coming later in the track listing. This one was the better one of the two, I think two or three, I can't remember. It was okay. I mean, it's pretty par for the course in terms of like boy band ballads and stuff. It just acoustic guitars, piano, you know, multiple nice, very light, airy harmonies and stuff. And just, you know, songs about relationships and loves and love and whatnot. And they're very cutesy and whatnot. It's, I don't know.
I'll never break your heart, girl. I'm always here for you. OMG, thank you so much, Nick Lachey.
we're gonna get to that one. Don't worry.
All right, it aged poorly. It's a ballad. Next track is another ballad, Spice Girls Goodbye, single version. Goodbye, my friend. Without Ginger Spice, by the way. It's after she left, so they became boring. It has a pulse behind it, so I'll give it that much.
Wow. I actually thought this one was okay. Yeah, you definitely... I never thought that I'd be the one to be more into the Spice Girls track than you. I mean, I'm surprised. I mean, I wasn't in love with it, but I thought it was okay. I did definitely prefer it to Because of You, actually, ever so slightly. And again, the one coming later, definitely preferred it to that one. So, but yeah, not a whole ton I really can say about this one. It was kind of an okay slow jam, decent goodbye ballad. Strings in the bridge were nice.
Cool. I have nothing else to say.
Neither do I.
Age Poorly is Bella next. Backstreet and Maya featuring Mace and Blinky Blink. Blinky Blink. Take me there. Street and rising R&B star Maya team up on Take Me There for the Rugrats soundtrack. The R&B supergroup Blackstreet currently features renowned producer Teddy Street Riley, Chauncey Black Hannibal, Eric Williams, and Mark Middleton. Maya's music career began as a dancer, but by age 15, her musical side began to take over and eventually led to collaborations with the likes of Kenneth Babyface Edmonds, Diane Warren, Missy Misdemeanor Elliott, and members of Drew Hill.
Rugrat sample.
Yeah, the thing is, I actually didn't know this was... I forgot this was in the movie. So when I reheard this, I immediately thought, like, what the fuck? Why does this sound like Rugrats? And I'm like, oh, that's why. Because it was in the movie.
I would expect you to know because you're the cartoon man.
I definitely am. Well, I do remember the Rugrats movie. I watched it as a kid and
so
quite enjoyed it.
I don't really
remember
much about it. I mean, all that was the introduction of the baby.
Yeah, that was Dill's first appearance, played by the lovely, legendary Tara Strong.
Tara Strong!
Yes, Tara Strong, she played the babe. She played Dill. I didn't know that until I was older.
I thought it was Dill and Lil, the twins.
No, Phil and Lil, they're the twins.
Oh, okay, right, because naming, right.
You gotta keep up on the Rugrats lore, you gotta know.
I had all the stuffed animals. Anyway, I like this one. It's fun. It lasts a little too long. This one does sound pretty Timbaland. I wonder if it was produced by Timbaland. I like that like on the other side of the speaker was a nice touch. And it was catchy.
I thought this one was kind of cheesy, to be honest. I mean, I get that it's for the Rugrats movie, so it's like, you know, I guess you make it to be fitting for that. I did actually like how they sampled like part of the theme song. I actually thought conceptually that was pretty nice and tied it to the franchise pretty nicely. But the first verse didn't do that much for me. The second verse, when it came in, I thought the vocals were better on that one. I think they just kind of were a bit more.
When they talk about the Rugrats themselves.
Oh, the rap verse though was I thought that was pretty dumb, especially in the video, which it's sometimes unfair to judge the song based on the video, but like it just I was watching the video for it. It's the section where they're like it's like them in like the Reptar car and it's like CG'd and like they're there running with the babies. I just thought that looked so dumb.
It's funny to hear like guys who would normally sing about being gangsta singing about taking me to wonders and fantasy and who they're probably actually talking about like a theme park or something and not sex.
Yeah. And they're talking about like yo Tommy Pickles and stuff like that with Dylan Lil and Chuck. It just had a
Disney World.
Oh god. No, it's so also the chorus I thought was kind of take me there. I want to go there. Take me there. It's like all right. Oh, it was kind of monotonous, not going to lie.
Yeah, I mean it's for a kids movie. I wouldn't say this track aged the greatest.
Nope.
Speaking of not all the puns in the world, because next up, R. Kelly, When a Woman's Fed Up, clean version.
It's like running out of love.
No matter what you say.
And then it's too late to talk about it. Now let's talk about how
speaking of not aging well,
R. Kelly delivers the hits that he's renowned on the multi-platinum R, featuring the devastatingly soulful When a Woman's Fed Up. It's an R&B track. Putting aside the fact that it's by the awful human being known as R. Kelly, it's alright. It's an R&B ballad. Again.
I don't have much to say about it. I was already kind of burnt out on the slow ballads by this point. I was just like, I genuinely don't remember too much about this track, so.
They could have mixed up the rock and the ballads a little more, because they do put all the good rock songs at the beginning, and then it's just like, ballad, 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 rap song, ballad, ballad, rap song.
Yeah, no, I do agree. Their distribution of the track list definitely could have been better. I may actually, weirdly enough, I feel like my impressions of some of the tracks might have been a bit better, and I may have been able to distinct them a bit better if like they just were broken up. It kind of like the last like the first edition of US edition of Now That's What I Call Music. I also felt like in the middle they stuck a lot of slow jams and ballads in the center, and it's like they just all started to bleed together for me. So
I think they get a bit better on that later on, but we'll be the judges of that. So
I suppose so.
It's an R&B ballad. It was mid, did not age the greatest. Next track, please be better. It is Everclear, Father of Mine.
Father of mine, tell me where have you been? You know I just closed my eyes, my whole world disappeared.
Father of Mine by Everclear. So, another top 10 hit for the multi-platinum album So Much for the Afterglow, Father of Mine shows Everclear's trademark sound and Art Alexakis' passionate lyrics. Very true. This is about his daddy problems.
It is.
His daddy gave him a name and he walked away.
Daddy gave me a name that he walked away.
I do love this one. Yeah!
No, this one's actually a really, really solid one. I was actually listening to quite a bit of Everclear like in anticipation for this podcast. And this is obviously one of the... This track was on the track listing. That's not redundant.
So much for the Afterglow, you listen to that?
Wasn't that album by itself. Mostly just like the greatest hits comp. Like I think it was like the 10 Years Wasted compilation. But yeah, this one's pretty solid, man. It's one of those classic Everclear tracks that's an upbeat song with some very heartfelt lyrics talking about old Art... What's his last name?
Art Alexakis.
Art Alexakis, yeah. Kind of digging into some of his personal stories and troubles. And yeah, this one deals with loss of childhood, dealing with his father of mine. And especially, like, I know we were just recording it earlier, but I actually really do think it's pretty solid lyrically. And especially even the line in the chorus, Daddy gave me a name and then he walked away. I think it's a really solid line. It especially works great for a chorus.
Him and the Madden brothers should team up and make the ultimate song about daddy issues.
Oh, totally, yeah. Everclear featuring Good Charlotte, yeah.
Kino? That sounds actually Kino.
It could be good. I mean, it would definitely be interesting. I'll say that.
The one line that everyone talks about is the controversial, the one like, I'm a scared white boy in a black neighborhood. But I mean, to tell the truth, wouldn't you be scared being the minority wouldn't you be scared being a minority even if you are like a majority in any other place?
I think that's the thing too. It's really just trying to paint the picture that he was in this different situation, and he felt like a loner and an outsider, especially again without his dad being there. So you feel just very unprotected. I mean, again, I guess it was kind of controversial to some. I didn't think of it as that controversial.
Neither did
personally.
I until someone like said like it is, and I'm like, wow, okay, I guess.
That's the thing about some controversies. You don't realize they're controversies until some people tell you. Is this a big deal? It's a big deal. Oh, okay.
I really like the track. He always, like,
same here.
Lets loose in the end and, like, really lets his emotions show. And I think he did that really well here.
I agree. And I think the music also followed suit as well. The swelling dynamics in the track, the string mm-hmm. parts especially, I thought were really mm-hmm. nice. And fun guitar solo as well. Also got to shout out that guitar solo. And yeah, that's, you have anything else to add?
Nope. Aged pretty well for me.
Same here.
Next track, Sublime, What I Got, clean version.
Loving is what I got. I said, remember that. Loving is what I got. I remember that. Loving is what I got.
Inspiring rave reviews from critics and fans alike, the album Sublime reached multi-platinum status. Sublime enjoyed great radio success on the radio with What I Got, which reached number one on the modern rock chart for 3 weeks. It doesn't seem like... That seems like too short a time for me, considering how huge Sublime still are. I think what's worth noting is that this song is like the oldest on here, I believe. Yeah, 1996, but after the singer died, like, of course, they got like more success and continued like releasing singles from that album even after the singer's death. Which yeah. I think that's very sweet. Like, people like started to appreciate them more, I think, and... Well, this track is pretty overplayed on the radio. I think it's still pretty good, and I always wait in anticipation for the "Life is so much." I always kind of like shout it at the top of my lungs.
Oh yeah, I do love the gaps from the clean version though are really funny. Yeah.
Oh, I'm pretty sure one of them was when the mom smokes pot.
Yeah, I think it was like when my mom smokes pot, then smoke, and then like hits the rock or something like that. I think like hits the bottle and then takes some rock or something. Or even like when he says like I can play the guitar like a motherfucking riot. It's just like I can play the guitar like a riot.
Listening to the clean is very important though to get you in the headspace of this album, to get you in the place of someone who listened to this album back in the day.
Oh yeah. Yes, what you guys say about What I've Got?
Oh, it's an upbeat track, really relaxed. Shout out to the dog, the mascot. It's just a chill track. I like it.
It is pretty sweet, pretty smooth. I dig the acoustic riffs and leads throughout are pretty fun. Mm-hmm. Love the sweet reggae groove and vocal rhythms. The vocal melody in the intro, which you, Caesar, I don't know if you know this or not, is actually heavily derived from Lady Madonna by the Beatles.
I did not know that.
If you do, if you listen to Lady Madonna by the Beatles, it sounds very similar. I don't know if it's a direct sample. At least if it was a direct sample, it was not credited, as far as I know. But, yeah. And I like the sentiment of the track. It's like, you know, liking life because, you know, you like life because it's happening right now and it's what you got. You know, I think that's a nice sentiment. Very sweet.
I think it aged well.
I'd have to agree.
All right, next track. You can rant all you want. Backstreet Boys, I'll Never Break Your Heart. Dominated the charts throughout the world, have won the hearts of millions, and show no sign of slowing down. I'll Never Break Your Heart is one of the breakthrough tracks from their self-titled debut, which has sold 10 million copies to date.
Do you want to start, or do you want to...
It's alright, it's boring. It's one of Backstreet Boys' worst songs. There, I said it. Done.
Well, I'd have to agree with you again. I'm not going to act like I'm the biggest Backstreet Boys fan in the world. I don't mind them. Again, Backstreet's back, all right. Damn good track. Great bass line. Even like some of their other ballads, like I Want It That Way, fine track. I'll Never Break Your Heart. Yeah, that's not bad. But I'll Never Break Your Heart. I feel like there's so many fucking boy band cliches in this one particular song. Even just the intro, to be honest, where it just starts off, it's like, baby, I know that you're hurting. You may feel like you can never love again. I was like, fucking gag me, please.
I know you got a B minus on your test, but you'll be better next time.
Yeah, it's like, it's totally, I don't know, something about just, there's so many generic lyrics in terms of like, you know, I feel like I'll die without you. And, you know, it's just like, I need you to be mine. Give me that. Something about this track felt kind of condescending to me. Maybe it's just me, but like the whole idea, it's just sort of like, I know that you've been really hurt, but like you're being really unfair, you bitch. You got to give me a chance to love you. I don't know. Maybe I'm kind of putting a narrative where there's not one, but just like through some of the lines, I don't know the angle they were taking. I get the idea. It's like, you know, it's like, oh, I'm not like those other guys and stuff like that. I'll actually love you. I'll never break your heart.
I just feel like again.
Oh God. Well, I mean, that's kind of a similar track. That's Shawn Mendes. Better. It was a Treat You Better, mm-hmm. Which is, I fucking hate. That's such a nice guy's song. I really hate it. Which I wouldn't say it's as bad as that, but let's just say. It's kind of pointing in a similar direction, I kind of feel, where it's just sort of like, you know, I'm not like those other guys, I'll never break your heart and stuff like that. You're being really unfair by not giving me a chance. It's like, you know, nothing is better than like a girl who's in emotional pain and just being just sort of like, you're being a dumb broad, you gotta trust me.
So, yeah, that album didn't age, that song didn't age the greatest. We're getting into agree. The final tracks here. Jay-Z, Hard Knock Life Ghetto Anthem, edit. On volume 2, Hard Knock Life, Jay-Z once again displays his dazzling lyrical acrobatics, stunning verbal versatility, and fierce driving beats. The success of the hit single Hard Knock Life helped push the album to number 1 on the Billboard album chart. Whoops, I slipped up and almost said Adam.
Oh, that's I'm not surprised.
For lore for the people who don't know, I absolutely stan Adam Lazara from Taking Back Sunday, and he is a huge Jay-Z fan. So whenever I hear Jay-Z, I think of him, and I'm listening to Jay-Z's albums because of him. So hurrah, they're pretty good though. I mean, I'm not gonna lie, it's just. I am a little burnt out right now because his albums are pretty freaking long. Anyway, I know you really like this track. The sample's cool. His rapping is good, and that's what I have.
Fair enough. You're definitely right. I do quite like this track. I think his use of the sample "Hard Knock Life" from Annie is really well implemented. No, I think that he incorporated it well. I think that the way that they slowed it down and gave it more of a, I think they gave it like a bit more of a swing to it, was quite nice. It's super, again, I love that like late 90s, super smooth, kind of grooves you'd see a lot in like different rap tracks at the time. Again, not like an expert in the genre, but like I tend to find this more in like some of the 90s stuff that I've heard. But yeah, overall, like super, super smooth, solid flow. Again, lyricism's pretty solid, as Jay-Z typically tends to bring, as far as I know. Yeah, I mean, again, it's pretty solid, but I don't actually have a whole ton to say about it, weirdly enough.
Neither do I. It's just a good song. All right, I think it aged pretty well.
I have to say so.
I don't know if we got to keep this up or not, but let's go to the last track. This is an interesting one. Baz Luhrmann, Everybody's Free to Wear Sunscreen, edit.
Ladies and gentlemen of the class of 99, wear... sunscreen. If I could offer you only one tip...
The album Something for Everybody is the eclectic, joyous, wonderful soundtrack to summer which Baz Luhrmann and his team have produced. Fueled by the success of the hit single Everybody's Free to Wear Sunscreen, the album has been certified gold. So it's a college speech, not college speech, it's a high school graduation speech set to music.
Yeah, I was not expecting that, to be honest. It was, I will say though...
Is that your first time hearing
it? Turned out to be it actually is, believe it or not. Yeah, wasn't expecting a spoken word, but it actually turned out to be a pretty pleasant surprise, to be honest. What'd you think of it?
Hey, I enjoy it. I really enjoy it. I'd say I enjoy it. It's very, very 90s. And do you know who Baz Luhrmann is?
I do not.
Who is he? A movie director. He is most famous for Romeo and Juliet with Leonardo DiCaprio and Claire Danes, and most recently, the Elvis movie.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, there you go.
So... he's a pretty cool dude. Movies are over the top and they have good music choices. I know that much. So I think it's interesting. He's like, you know what? I'm a director, but maybe I want to make a song. So he did. Well, kind of.
I think he didn't really sing it. One who says the speech, and I know it was changed a little bit because the original says to the class of 98, and this one, this is class of 99. Fun fact.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's inspirational. Oh. It's a high school graduation speech. It's going to be inspirational. So, yeah, I think it's pretty cool.
I think it's a very interesting way, just in the context of the whole CD, interesting way to close out the record for sure.
Actually,
it's like, well, we've listened to a lot of different ballads and, you know, alternative rockers and stuff like that, you know, a couple of rap tracks. How about we end things on a graduation speech set to synth pads and bongos and light guitars? It's like, sure, okay.
Oh, hey, so it's narrated by Australian voice actor Lee Perry, who is known for portraying various characters in either direct-to-video or theatrical relisted movies.
Oh, yes, those ones, my favorites.
Oh, yes, very interesting.
Here's the real question. Would you say this track dated well?
It is very 90s, and it should only belong in the 90s.
Fair enough, I'd definitely agree there.
No, it didn't, but doesn't matter. No.
I think it's fine.
No one remembers this track now.
I honestly...
Maybe it's best to be forgotten, but not in a mean way.
It's just kind of... It is what it is, and it was fine at the time, but it's like... I guess you're not really missing much if you don't hear it now, I guess.
All right. So I think that wraps up our episode 2 of the Now That's What I Call Music podcast. What were your top 3 favorite songs go?
Good question. I'd have to say, without much of a shadow of a doubt, I'm going to say Father of Mine by Everclear. What is there? That's Never There by Cake. And I'm really batting between Closing Time and Hard Knock Life. I'm going to say Closing Time.
All right. My favorites are Baby One More Time by Britney Spears. I Think I'm Paranoid by Garbage. And Closing Time by Semisonic. So
all right, then.
I think we've got some
good picks.
Good ones. I don't really feel like we need to say our least favorites because we've already spoken about those. Oh, they're all the ballads. No need to rank them. They're all just like...
But if I had to pick one, I would say I'll Never Break Your Heart is my least favorite.
I don't know. I'd say the 98 Degrees one. I was about to say NSYNC. So
no, they're different.
Yeah. So that was episode 2. Let's hope for cooler, better, hipper, funner songs next time in volume 3, where we go to 1999 again. So see
once
you
again.
There.
Alrighty.
Bye.
Call now.